I am a true girl. Won't believe the lie that beauty's on the outside, outside. When the world's against me, I wanna shine bright, shine bright. The love of Jesus will show in my life, my life. The truth that set me free and your light will always shine. Cause I know who I am, got joy down in my heart. I know God's got a plan, he's known me from the start. I am a true girl. I am a true girl. Jesus is my foundation. Tell the whole world I am a new creation. I am free. I am a masterpiece. And I am fearfully and wonderfully me. I am a true girl. I am a true girl. I am a true girl. I am a true girl.
Well, good afternoon, true girls and moms. I'm Stacy coming to you from Michigan.
Hey, girls. It's Abby coming to you from State College, Pennsylvania.
Hi, guys. It's good to see you again. I'm Casey coming at you from Ohio.
Happy Music Monday. We go live every day at noon Eastern time with a live-taught interactive homeschool elective. And we're having a blast learning so many cool new things. So subscribe to us on our YouTube channel to join us every day.
That's right. And today is one of our favorite days of this very week because we're focusing on the amazing toe-tapping, hand-clapping, finger-snapping gift of music. Do you guys like that?
I like that a lot.
Thank you, Stacy. Have you ever wondered what exactly makes music so hard to resist? And like, it's probably because the song has such a catchy rhythm or great beat. But rhythm is actually the basis of all music. And today, this very day, we have a super special guest joining us to teach us just exactly how rhythm works.
Yes, Suzy Weibel is going to be joining us in just a few minutes. She's an author and speaker that you may have seen on the Secret Keeper Girl tour way back in the day. And she actually toured with us for over 10 years, which is a really long time. And now she's a member of our board and helps to keep this ministry growing. But she's also an amazingly talented drummer. So today she's going to be teaching us about rhythm. She's totally awesome, and you are going to love hearing from her.
Yes, I'm so excited about this. You guys know I'm like always making a beat. If you give me like two pencils, I'm going to town, right? But anyways, girls, we want to remind you to have your mom snap a pic of you while you're hanging out with us during our daily electives. So just be like, Mom, can you get me? Smile real nice. She'll get you. And then we'll use it to welcome everybody each day. Like, check this one out. Look at our friend. So she's cute. So cute. And look, I at love her Bible.
Bible.
Guys, I did that to my Bible over the weekend.
Did you?
Yep, I added pages.
Oh, that was my plan. I didn't get to it, but I can't wait to do it.
Yeah, it was fun.
But yeah, if you go ahead and take a picture and have your mom upload it to Facebook or Instagram and tag us, we'll make sure to pull one and use it each day to welcome you guys. So make sure you do that, all right?
Oh, we can't wait to see you guys in your faces, especially after today, learning about all the things we're going to be doing with rhythm. It's going to be really fun. So now I would love to move into our freedom stories. You guys have been sending in some great stories, and please know, even if we don't read your story out loud on this, we still read your story and we are praying for you, and it has been encouraging us. A verse that True Girl likes to use at our ministry is John 8:31-32. And it says, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." It's such an awesome, awesome word. Just whenever you're feeling kind of like those sticky feelings, we really like to go back to that verse, because it just tells us how the word of the Lord is the truth, and the truth sets us free. And so right now I'd like to share with you a verse that I was actually reading either last night or the night before. It is 1 John 5:20-21. And it says this, "And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols." For me, when I read that, I was kind of like, okay, John, this is kind of a really strange tangent that you're going on right here. We just read about how Jesus is the truth and the Son of God will set you free. And then he ends the whole book of 1 John with that sentence, "Little children, keep yourself away from idols." And so after I read that, it reminded me of a song that Jimmy Needham wrote. I don't know if Kelly's on here, Kelly Needham and the girls, but hello if you are. She came to one of our shows with her daughters, but her husband wrote a song called "Clear the Stage." And in the bridge of the song, since we're talking about music, I thought I would bring this up. It says, "Anything that I think about more than God is an idol. Anything that I love with all of my heart is an idol. Anything that I can't stop thinking of is an idol." And so I'm like, wow, it must have been really important for John to finish this book with that statement, "Little children, keep yourselves away from idols." I think right now we're in a time I am experiencing where the coronavirus can very much so become an idol. Just thinking about everything that's going on, I think fear can become an idol. But this verse just really reminded me, Jesus Christ is the truth. His word is the truth. He will set us free. Let us not fix our mind on everything that's happening, but let's take every thought captive and just focus on Jesus, and he will keep our paths literally straight. So I hope that encourages you guys this morning, because I know it really encouraged me. So here's a freedom story we have from Ava. "My older friend, who I have known since I was little," okay, "was little's husband fell down pretty bad. And then my other friend's mom, aunt, and great grandmother got diagnosed with COVID-19. I have been praying for them. This morning, my mom and I read the verse that helped me. It was Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and don't rely on your own understanding, but acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will make your path straight." Oh my goodness, it connects. I'm sorry. It's so awesome. "He will guide me through his word always. That makes me feel better, and I know he will always help me because he loves me. I know he will speak to me in his word, and I can turn to him every day, no matter what." That's incredible. Praise the Lord, Ava. We are so thankful that you would share that with us, and that the Lord hears you enough to connect both of the things we were saying before I even read this. Oh, that's so great. He does love you. He loves all of you so much, truly, truly. So if any of you have a freedom story, we want them. As you can see, the Lord is moving, and it's so encouraging to us, and I'm sure you girls listening as well, just to share these with each other and to bear each other's burdens with each other and to hear how the Lord is doing such good things in your lives. So if you have a freedom story right now, you can drop it in the chat, and we will look over them tonight and share them tomorrow. So we're looking forward to hearing your stories.
Yes, and right now we are going to meet our super special guest, Suzy Weibel, and she's actually going to be doing a Q&A time. So make sure if you have any questions for her about rhythm, about her awesome hair, about her cajon, make sure you drop them in the chat so that she can answer those questions. All right, let's see her. Hi, Suzy. Thank you so much for being here today.
Ah! Hey, there we go. I'm here. Now I can be heard. All right. All right, coming to you from our music room. We got like a little bit of music stuff behind me. Computer's actually on the keyboard here. Where'd everybody go? You all froze.
We're here.
Oh, there we go.
We're just giving you the stage.
Excellent. That was a little strange. All right, are we ready to rock and roll? With some
music? Oh, yeah. Take it away.
Hi, girls. So yeah, I'm here in the music room and we're going to talk a little bit about rhythm today. And so I just want to start just telling you a little bit about my background with rhythm, because it might be like your background with rhythm. So my background with rhythm started when I was very young and I didn't know that I was experiencing a rhythm instrument, because I started when I was probably about 5 or 6 years old and my mom started me with piano lessons. So I can't see you right now, but go ahead and raise your hand if you've taken piano lessons. I can see Casey and Abby. There we go. Stacy's frozen again. But anyhow, so I didn't really, there she is. Hey, I didn't really care that much for piano. I practiced. I liked playing what I liked playing. You know, I did the recitals and that kind of thing, but I didn't realize it was a rhythm instrument. And so like Abby, Casey, Stacy, did you know, I mean, like, do you typically think of piano as a rhythm instrument?
No,
like, really? More than I do, but I think if you had asked me, I would have said, well, it's a string instrument, right? Because if you open up the inside of a piano, it's got all those strings in it. But if you think about it, there's little hammers that are hitting those strings, and that's what makes the resonant sound. And so it wasn't until I was an adult that somebody told me that at its, you know, most pure form, a piano is a rhythm instrument. So in eighth grade, I remember joining the little eighth grade band, and there were probably about 9 or 10 of us. We weren't great, but I was introduced to a reed instrument. Then I started playing clarinet, and I can still, anybody, how about just a few of you that I can see, did anybody else play clarinet?
Or yes, anything? I did. That was awful. When you said it, I cringed.
Smell like, the reed?
Yep.
Yes. Like that will never leave my scent memory, like bringing that instrument up. And so I played that. And then in high school, I think I didn't play in freshman year, but I was watching the marching band out on the football field. And I was like, that looks fun. So I picked up the clarinet again, and you know, I was proficient by my senior year. I think I was like first clarinet, you know, somewhere in that range. Got pretty good, played in the orchestra, marching band, and I enjoyed it. But at football games, I would always hand my clarinet off to a friend because he played that big bass drum, and I didn't march with it, but I learned all the spirit songs, like, and I would play the bass drum up in the stands. I loved that. Loved it. So then fast forward like into my 30s, and I'm married to Jonathan. He's a worship leader and a songwriter, and he had written his first worship album. And it was good. It was a good little album. And I'm like, oh no, that little stinker, he's going to start traveling all across the country, playing his music, and I'm going to be left behind. And I was like, I do not want to be left behind. So he said, why don't you play guitar? You can pick up the guitar. And I was like, no, I know guitar is not the right instrument for me. And then we were at a friend's house in Indiana. We're in Lawrenceburg, Indiana, just across the river from Cincinnati. And our friend had a drum kit in his basement. And he's like, you want me to teach you a song? And I'm like, no, I can't learn a song. And he said, no, seriously, it's not that hard. I'm going to teach you a real basic rhythm. So I'm going to show you one that was popular in the 50s. And so he sits me down and he has me bring out some sticks. Let's see if we can see this here. Can you see this? Can you see my hands? All right, hard to see from here. And he did. He taught me just this really basic beat. And actually, if you guys can go, do you know this right here? This boom. Yeah, and pretty soon I realized that what he had me playing was, are you doing that thing you do? Breaking my heart into a million pieces like you always do. Are you? And I sat there and I played those drums for hours that first night. Hours, and it wasn't, I mean, I couldn't do it very proficiently, but like something was happening and I loved it. And I said, Jonathan, when we get back home, will you buy me a drum set? And he did. I got a drum set for my 32nd birthday. That's when I started playing.
Amazing. I love that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. And so I absolutely, absolutely loved it. And that was, it kind of brought back the fact that, oh yeah, I loved this when I was in high school. The instrument I always stole was the drum. So it made sense. And I've had so many great opportunities since then. Gotten to play a lot of cool places. So let me talk to you about really quickly about why I love it. I love it because it's like any other art form. It's really fun to go back and look at what you've created. Or in this case, maybe to listen to what you've created. I just love like putting on a CD that I've played on or looking at, like we just recorded 5 songs with Abby on Friday morning, you know, and it's just fun to go back and play those again and to just say, I was part of the team that created that. And that's the other thing that I love is the teamwork that's involved in music. You can do it by yourself. You can just layer loop after loop after loop and be a one girl band. But the teamwork, the community is so much fun in music. So those are some things I love. Another thing I love about it is this week I discovered a little 9-year-old drummer from England, I guess. And she's got a YouTube channel. She's been on the Ellen Show. But when she plays, 9 years old, keep this in mind. She's, first of all, she's awesome, but she screams when she plays sometimes. She'll be doing these mad fast fills. And while she's filling, she's just like, ah! And screaming. And she was asked in an interview, why do you do that? And she said, I get tight. And she said, when I scream, she said, it just loosens everything up and I feel free. And I think I've experienced that playing the drums. It's something you can hit hard and there's this freedom that comes with it. It just releases all the tightness. So I want to talk really quickly about how you can begin if drumming, if rhythm is something that you're interested in. And I actually started this way too. Yes, somebody showed me that first beat. But what I would really do, I'm going to bring up on my screen here some music. What I would really do, and I'm going to move over here. All right, let me make sure I can be seen first. It's going to be a little awkward for 2 seconds here. I want to bring, there we go. Can you see? Everybody see a cajon? Can you see my hands? Okay, great. So I'm going to bring up some music just really quickly. And the first song I'm going to play is a song that's in 4-4 time. Most music is written in 4-4 time. And the way that I started is I just started playing songs and practicing counting the time. So just listen to this. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, there you go. That's why it's called 4-4 time, because while the song's playing, you can count to fours. But look how that plays out with the hands and listen to my counting. So this is how I started. You can do it with sticks. I'm going to be on an instrument that's called a cajon. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. That all happened kind of fast, but what I was doing there is I was doing, first of all, quarter notes, 2, 3, 4, then half, then 2 and 3 and 16ths, 1e and a 2e and a 3e and a 4e and a. And what number do you get if you double 16?
32.
That's, let's see if you can hear this. You can see my hands. Those are 16th notes then. The same. So what I would do is I would find a song. I would count along with the beat, just with the quarter notes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a. And that's probably enough for now, because the 16ths, that comes later. All right. So that's the first way that I start. And most songs are in 4-4. I could play a 6-8 song here, but we'll just skip that. I think it's enough to just start with the idea of a 4-4 song and just maybe even tap your foot along with it. There we go. Now you can see my hands. Can you see my foot?
Forever he is glorified.
So I would try to sing along with songs. I would count along with songs. It's something that you can do when you're in the car. You can just take one hand and just be padding along like this. And if you do it quietly, it doesn't even bother whoever's driving. And then you can practice your eighth notes. And then you can go to 16ths. And you can do that with any song. But the trick is you have to start with a song that's a little bit slow, like Forever. Because if you're trying to do 30 second notes on a song that's already a rock song, whew, you're gonna be hurting. So anyhow, that's just a little bit of a primer of how to get started with rhythm. All right, you don't wanna try to start right. I mean, I started on a kit right away, but like I said, I wasn't really great the first night that I did it. I just kind of got the basics down. If you take drum lessons, if you're gonna work on rhythm, if you join a marching band, they're gonna make you start with the basics. They're gonna make you start with a book and they're gonna give you a drum pad and they're just gonna tell you, okay, quarter notes, one and two and three and four and, all right? Well, actually that was eighth notes. But that's how you're going to start, and it doesn't sound really fun, but you know what? If you put music on with it, especially your favorite songs, it begins to be fun because you begin to get a feeling that you're part of what's going on there. So now let's get to the other thing I want to talk about. All right. Do I have a few minutes here? All right. The other thing I want to talk about is this. I'm going to do a game called Two Truths and a Lie. If the girls type something, can you ladies see them? Okay. So I'm going to share three things about myself. Two things are true, and one of the things is not true. The game is called Two Truths and a Lie. And I want you girls to see if you can guess what my lie is. All right. Number one. I have a college degree in acting. Number two, I have been on stage in front of thousands of people at once. And number three, I am an extrovert, meaning I get charged, I get energy from being with people. Which one is not true? Let's hear some of what the girls are saying. You can just type one word like actor if you don't think I was a college degree in acting, or you could say stage if you don't think I've been in front of thousands of people, or extra.
A lot of number three is
a lot of number threes. Yeah.
Oh, they've caught on to me. Yeah. I'm actually what's called a high introvert, which people think is funny because they're like, really? Because you made a living being on the stage. But it's true. I'm a high introvert. And so what I want to talk to you about is I want to talk to you about the way that God has made us and knowing how God has made you and working within the framework of how he made you. Because when we fight against God and against how he made us, it can make for a really bumpy road. I'm going to do that by telling you a story. I'm going to tell you a story about a couple guys that were in our youth group. My husband was a youth pastor for years. And so but this is a long time ago now. These guys are grown up. They have families, they have kids. But there were two guys in our youth group. They were best friends, and their names were Luke and Evan. And I tell this story a lot because I think it's such a powerful example. So Luke is a great musician. He is a great musician. He lives in Nashville today. He's a guy that from the time he was young, if you hand him an instrument, 1 week later, he's proficient. Like you could put him on stage and he could play with a band. An instrument he's never played before, give it to him, say, Luke, come back in 1 week. Yeah, he may not be like a professional, but he can hang with the band a week later. He was touring the country by the time he was 12 years old, playing mostly drums and percussion. But one day we were out with him and he was with us in the capacity of a percussionist. And I don't remember what happened, but somehow we didn't have an electric guitar player with us, like someone who could play the leads on the songs. And Luke just picks up an electric guitar, which we had never seen him play before, and just starts ripping these amazing leads. And needless to say, we put away all the percussion instruments and he played electric from that time on. He's excellent. And he's still in the music industry today. He books all the events today for Michael W. Smith and for King and Country. So Evan, his best buddy, is a great athlete. Evan is small, but in high school, he not only played varsity basketball, he also nearly broke the scoring record for his high school. He was selected from his small Pennsylvania school to go to this prestigious camp in England, and he worked out there with college and NBA basketball players. So this little thing happened when the guys were in about ninth grade. They became a little bit jealous of one another's gifts, and Luke decided that he wanted to be a basketball player. So he tried out, I think it was for the ninth grade basketball team. And I've played basketball with Luke. He's decent. He's just not varsity basketball good. And so Luke got cut from the team. And Evan tried to pick up the guitar and play that. And he just couldn't get to the point where he could, you know, get on the worship team. So basically, you know, what the guys, and they were depressed about it. I remember them being upset, you know, because they were best friends and they wanted to be just like one another. But what the guys learned from this is that God created them differently with different gifts. And I know that we hear a lot in our world today, you can be anything you want to be. And that's really actually not a true thing when people say that. You can become better at anything that you work hard at, but you can't be anything that you want to be. I grew up wanting to be a Major League Baseball player. It wasn't gonna happen. And I was a pretty good baseball player. Just because we're pretty good at something doesn't mean that we can, you know, become anything that we want to be. Working hard has an awful lot of merit. But the if we look at first, let's look at 1 Corinthians together. I'm gonna look at 1 Corinthians 12. All right. And we're going to start with verse 14, because God addresses this idea. He talks about how he created us, and he compares us as the church to the human body. So listen to this. All right. The human body has many parts, and the foot might say, because I'm not a hand, I'm not part of the body. But saying this would not stop the foot from being part of the body. And the ear might say, well, because I'm not an eye, I'm not part of the body. But saying this would not stop the ear from being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, it would not be able to hear. If the whole body were an ear, it would not be able to smell. If each part of the body were the same part, there would be no body. But truly, God put all the parts, each one of them, in the body as he wanted them. So then there are many parts, but one body. And I think that Luke and Evan had a great experience in high school.
Oh, Susie, I think you accidentally muted yourself.
Yeah, we lost you. You see all of our eyes? We said
right at the best part, too. So they learned that even though they were best friends, like, you know, they were like one. They wouldn't be the dynamic duo that they were if they were both the same. And so I want you girls to realize that too. Try a lot of different things. Try a lot of different art forms. Try different musical instruments. Expect to be good at some things, and just okay at some other things. And there might be a couple of things you find that you're actually kind of not very good at all at. And that would be normal. That's all of us. You know, there are things we're great at, and we learn that right away. There are things that we're just okay at, but they're fun. And there are things that we go, ooh, I'm not gonna try that again. All right, so are there any quick questions or?
Yeah, I see a few here. Let me find one, I just lost it. Oh, wait, where did it go? Oh, Ari, a couple people wanna know what your favorite instrument is.
Well, I mean the drums. Yeah. I like to play kit, so my favorite is, so I have a number of instruments here. I have played, I've played like congas and bongos. I've played the djembe. I've played the cajon. But I mean, there's nothing that compares to playing a kit.
Yes.
So I play guitar too. But that's one of those things where I'd be like, I'm just okay. Mm-hmm. You know?
Well, I've seen you play and you're better than just okay. So Jamie wants to know if you've been really famous.
No, I'm going to say I've never been really famous. And
come on, you were on a Secret Keeper Girls stage.
Yeah, that was
yeah, it. I think that you saying
that was the peak.
I think that you saying that you've spoken in front of thousands of people probably makes them think that you're.
Yeah. Well, we got to play some really cool gigs. Like we played with Ravi Zacharias and we played with, oh, who else? Oh, well, we did I think of the picture that I sent, and I don't know if you ever used it, Stacy, was we did that one event with a skillet and jars of clay. And
yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Awesome.
But that's not fame. So don't get that confused.
Wow. Eliza wants to know how many instruments you can play.
Well, you know, probably everything in the percussion family. And then I'm if I were to practice, I'd probably be pretty decent at piano or keys and guitar, but I don't practice. And I bet I could learn bass and get pretty good at that. But it's, you know what? It's how much time do you want to put into it? The things that we're good at are the things that we actually put time into. The reason I became decent at drums is Jonathan not only bought me, my husband not only bought me a drum set, but he built a room in our basement that became our drum cave. I spent hours down there. I mean, hours. I would disappear at 4 o'clock in the afternoon and I'd come out at 11 o'clock at night.
Wow.
That's what it takes to get good. Mm-hmm. And so girls, lock that in. You know, we can't cry about not being good at things if we're not willing to put the time into it to become good. People who are good, they've earned that title.
Preach.
Hours. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Well, thank you for answering all their questions. That was awesome. Yeah. They really loved you. I got so many comments that were like, this is awesome. That's incredible.
We'll have to figure out a way to make it. We couldn't play the drums because it just was like, it just was white noise. Otherwise we would have actually done
maybe
something.
Maybe we can get a video sometime and play it later.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much, Suzy. That was so fun.
Awesome having you on.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. But for now, girls, if you can just drop some prayer requests. We already have a few that I'm going to find, although I can't. Oh, there they are. So I'm just going to pray for a couple right now. And just remember, we say this every time, that if you listed your prayer request and we're not praying for it out loud, it doesn't mean that we're not praying for it at all. So I just want to reinstate that at all. So Olivia says, my friend's family is positive with COVID-19, and I would like to pray for them. Absolutely. Willow says, please pray for all healthcare workers facing coronavirus all over the world. Please pray for them to remember that God is with them. And that is very true and very good. Heather says, I'm scared of the bad weather and there have been tornadoes near me. Please pray for all the people by me. And just seeing that lots of you girls have seen or know people that have the coronavirus. So we're just going to be praying for all of those. So if you can all bow your heads with me, and we're just going to pray over these things. Father God, I thank you that you hear us. And I thank you that you know our prayer requests before we even pray them, or before we even write them in a YouTube chat column or a Facebook chat column. I pray for Olivia's family that all tested positive with COVID-19. God, I just ask that you would heal them, make sure that they stay inside and get healthy really fast. But God, I just pray for comfort that they wouldn't be experiencing pain during this time, but that it would just run its course and that it would run its course quickly. God, I just want to lift up all the healthcare workers that are on the front lines at this time, that are the first responders, that really can't get out of this. It's their job, and they're probably the most important people right now, just making sure everyone's staying safe and getting healthy as soon as possible. I just praise you for their hard work and their dedication. I just ask that you would keep them safe and that you would remind them, even if they don't know you, that they have a purpose that is greater than this, that is greater than themselves. God, I pray that just this would point a lot of people towards you. And I pray for Heather and her family. I just ask that you would comfort her, that you would remind her that you're bigger than tornadoes and that you're in charge of it all. So I just pray for protection for her city, for her, for the place that she lives and her house and her family, that you would just prevent the tornadoes to come near them. And God, I just lift up everyone who has coronavirus or know people who have coronavirus, that they would just get better quickly and that they would not be fearful of what's to come. And we praise you for everything that you're doing in our lives. I just thank you for technology that we're able to talk to these girls, even if it's not in person and we can't hug them or anything like that, but we can still have a conversation with them and make sure they're doing okay. I thank you for who you are, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so before we let you guys go, you know we got some stuff to tell you every time. Nothing's changed. Here we go. It's coming up, guys. The best party in the world. The crazy hair party is coming up. We're planning for it right now. We're planning the games. We're doing all this stuff. Am I lying, guys?
No. No, this is the truth.
It's going to be great. So you got to make sure that you register to attend that. It's going to be Friday, May 1st from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can find out how to register for that by going to mytruegirl.com/crazyhair. We want you guys to be there. It's going to be so fun. You do not want to miss it. And I also want to tell you guys, I'm very excited about tomorrow. Casey's going to tell you a little bit more in a second, but
yes,
make sure you have a basketball with you tomorrow, okay?
Oh, I cannot wait for that. Sorry, I'm just so excited. I can barely contain myself. And an extra special thanks to our friend, Suzy Weibel. Let's give it up for her for being with us. Thank you so much, Suzy. Well, that's a wrap for today, guys. We'll see you tomorrow for health and fitness class. We're going to be doing some good stuff with a basketball, so prepare yourself. All right, who wants to sign us out?
Stacy.
Okay, yeah. me. Hey, see you Tuesday. Hey.